In this lesson, I'm going to give you an overview of the various AWS migration tools that are available, and then we're going to look at what's known as the 7 R's of migration. So, in terms of migration tools, let's say we have some infrastructure in an on-premises data center on the right-hand side here, and we want to migrate some of that data and the applications into AWS. So we might have servers, and we might have database systems, and we might have things like NAS servers or file servers of some sort. Now, firstly, whenever you're using the migration tools, you'll generally need to connect a VPN at the very least, or use Direct Connect, but you can in some cases use the internet as well. Direct Connect would often be preferred, and you've got to make sure that the quantity of data that you have is going to work in terms of your time frames if you're using, for instance, the internet. With a Direct Connect, you have more bandwidth typically, so you might be able to migrate your data more quickly. Firstly, we have the Application Discovery Service. So this helps us to discover our applications and can find some information, so essentially an inventory of data about our applications. Then we have the Migration Service, the Application Migration Service. Now, what we can do with the Application Migration Service is we can migrate things like our servers as or virtual machines into AWS, and they can then be migrated into EC2 instances. Now, if we have databases on premises, then we can use the Database Migration Service, and we might need the Schema conversion tool as well in some cases. So here we might be migrating a database from on-premises to RDS. That could, of course, be an Oracle database, it could be a SQL database, it could be a MySQL database. And then we've got Data Sync. Data Sync is the service for migrating our data. So our data might be stored on a NAS system, could be an SMB store like a Microsoft file server, and we want to migrate that into AWS. And the destinations will include the EFS file system, Amazon S3, and also Amazon FSx as well. Let's have a look at the 7 R's of migration. Now, you will find this sometimes documented as 6 R's, just a slight nuance between them, but AWS does refer to this as the 7 R's. Now, what are the 7 R's of migration? Well, these are a way to categorize how you're going to treat your different systems and servers and applications and data on premises. What are you going to do with it when you migrate? So let's say you're decided to close down your on-premises data center, or you want to at least try and migrate as much as you can into AWS. So what are you going to do with each application? Firstly, you might retire. So you might identify some applications, you don't need them anymore. Let's just get rid of them. Second R is to retain, leave as is. So that means that you might maintain that system in your on-premises data center. Maybe you purchased it fairly recently and you want to depreciate it over time. Maybe it's an application that's difficult to migrate to the cloud. So for now, you're just going to leave it as it is. Another is to relocate. That means to move without modification, sometimes known as lift and shift. Now, relocate might literally be where, let's say you are migrating between 2 on-premises data centers. And what you want to do is pick up a server, stick it into a truck, put it into another data center, it goes back in the rack, it gets plugged in, you haven't changed anything. You've literally just shut it down, moved it to another location, and then you boot it back up again. Now, that's what I would call a traditional lift and shift. Doesn't really apply so much in the cloud. Next, we have Rehost. This is also known as lift and shift in AWS's terminology. Now, in this case, you're taking your OS or your application from the on-premises data center and you're moving it to AWS. So for example, you might have a virtual machine running on VMware and you want to migrate that virtual machine to Amazon EC2. So there is a bit of change here. You're changing the underlying hypervisor and the platform on which that operating system is running does incur some changes. So I think of it as being a little bit more than a lift and shift, but this is what AWS call it. Next you have repurchase. And with a repurchase, you're essentially saying, well, I'm going to use something different. So maybe I was running an application on premises and there's a software as a service solution that I could use instead. So rather than running my own infrastructure, either in the cloud or on premises, I'll just leverage the SaaS solution. Now, note on the right hand side here, we're going from least effort to most effort. So retiring, of course, you're just shutting it off. Pretty straightforward. As long as you don't have to migrate too much data off, you know, maybe it's just a system you don't really use much anymore. Retain usually means that you don't have to do much at all either. So those are right at the bottom. Now, as we get higher up, these are becoming a bit more complex, a bit more effort in terms of planning, in terms of the migration effort. Now, repurchasing doesn't come out at the top here, but if you were migrating, for example, from an on-premises CRM solution to something like Salesforce, if the formats of the source and destination are very different, you know, your system might be very different on-premises to in that cloud-based solution, then that could also be a very complex project. Now, the next one up is we have replatform. So for example, you might move a database to RDS or a server onto Elastic Beanstalk. So it's not just becoming or coming from a virtual machine into EC2, but it's also going onto a new platform. Now with Beanstalk, for example, you're actually then separating essentially the operating system and the code layer because it's a platform as a service solution. And with the database, you're moving from a self-managed database to a managed platform as a service as well. The last one is to refactor. This means to re-architect to a cloud-native serverless architecture. Typically, at least, that's what it means. So this is going to include quite a lot of effort and planning, especially if your application stack is designed in a more legacy way. But it can also bring the most benefits because you're starting to really leverage the best features of the cloud, the serverless, the event-driven architectures, and of course, decoupling message buses and that kind of thing. When we're migrating to AWS using AWS technology, typically we're going to use one of these three options. We're going to rehost, replatform, or refactor. Now, let's have a look at these in a bit more detail. So for rehost, your OS and app is moved to another host system. For this, AWS recommend the Application Migration Service, also known as AWS MGN. You can also use the SMS service, the Server Migration Service, or AWS VM Import Export. So you've got your data center with your VMware virtual machines or your Hyper-V virtual machines, and you have the replication agent installed. For VMware, there's also a vCenter agentless replication, so you can integrate into vCenter directly. Then, those systems using the migration service are migrated to EC2 instances. And of course, you have a test and cutover option as well, so you can perform some testing, synchronize the systems ahead of time, and then when you're ready, you can cut them over. Next, let's have a look at replatforming. So here, a couple of options would be to use the database migration service in the Schema conversion tool, or, and that's in case of a database, or you might want to migrate to Elastic Beanstalk using a custom AMI or a code level migration. There's a moderate amount of development and migration effort. So for example, you've got your database in your on-premises data center and use DMS to migrate to Amazon Aurora. Lastly, we have refactoring. So here, for example, we're re-architecting to a cloud-native serverless architecture. We can leverage things like serverless services and event-driven architecture patterns. You can migrate your servers to serverless functions or containers like on Lambda and ECS. You can migrate databases to managed DBs or serverless NoSQL DBs like DynamoDB. And you can migrate your file stores to object stores like S3 or Elastic File Systems like Amazon EFS. You get to decouple with queues, notification services, and orchestration tools. So all the real high-value stuff we talk about in the cloud. Now, this may involve a large amount of development and migration effort as well as expense. Now, of course, if this does work for your workload, then over time, this can be a very good investment in time and effort and expense.